Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of 2022 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. The first agenda item is to agree whether to take item 3 in private, which is consideration of today's evidence. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. And the next agenda item is to continue taking evidence on women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work. The evidence session will have an intersectional focus on disability. We have two witnesses who are joining us remotely, and I welcome to the meeting Dr. Pauline Nolan, Head of Leadership and Civic Partnership of Inclusion Scotland, and Jenny Miller, Chief Executive of PAMIS, Promoting a More Inclusive Society. I welcome you both to the meeting and refer members to papers 1 and 2. I'm now going to invite both of our witnesses to make a brief opening statement, starting with Dr. Pauline Nolan, please.
Thank you very much. Without wanting to correct you, it's Head of Leadership and Civic Participation. Thank you for the introduction. And Inclusion Scotland and I, of course, welcome the opportunity to contribute evidence to the Equalities, Human Rights and Civic Justice Committee about disabled women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work. And I am particularly glad to join you on International Women's Day to highlight some of the intersectional challenges that disabled women and women affected by disability have experienced over the last 2 years. Just briefly say a little bit about Inclusion Scotland. We are a disabled people's organisation led by disabled people ourselves. Inclusion Scotland works to achieve positive changes to policy and practice so that we disabled people are fully included throughout all Scottish society as equal citizens. We do this by influencing decision makers, supporting disabled people to be decision makers themselves, and developing capacity and awareness and engagement of disabled people. We have a network of 50 disabled people's organisation members across Scotland and many partners, and we have a large reach through our things like our newsletter. And we've built up a strong reputation as an independent, non-party political representative organisation of disabled people across Scotland. And I just wanted to really, without going over the opening statement that my colleague Susie gave, because I had prepared a very similar opening statement, really wanted to open with the words of a disabled woman that I had the utmost respect and still have the utmost respect for. This is a quotation taken from Glasgow Disability Alliance, one of our largest disabled people's organisation members, and it's from Susan McKinistry, who was their policy and participation officer and sadly died at the beginning of February. But she has for a long time been a very active intersectional disabled activist. And these are her words, her thoughts about disabled women. We are individuals with skills, talents and life experience filled with the kinds of ingenuity and adaptability which are essential attributes when living in a still inaccessible world. Our human rights to safety, stability and the choices over how we live our lives are more than dry and burdensome obligations which we must begrudgingly met. They are an opportunity to bring a richness of talent and expertise to bear in meeting the challenges we face nationally and globally. Until disability is seen as a rich and useful facet of human experience and not as an individual deficiency, this cannot happen. The person with the insight into how to tackle some of the critical social or environmental issues today may already exist but be trapped in a system which deprives them of the choice over when to use the toilet, let alone share their knowledge. And I think that's a really powerful statement to begin with. And I'll just close my opening statement by saying all the evidence that I present today, both from our own and GDA's surveys during the pandemic and the Fawcett Society, along with Women's Budgets Group and also Sisters of Frieda, which is a disabled women's organisation UK-wide, shows that disabled women and women, including disabled women, caring for a disabled person has been hit harder by COVID-19, not only because they may have been at greater risk of severe illness, but equally or more so because COVID-19 has supercharged the existing inequality they already face and made new inequality likely. Thank you.
Thank you. And now can we go to Jenny Miller, please?
Good morning, and as Pauline said on International Women's Day, PAMIS welcomes the opportunity to hashtag break the bias and provide evidence to the committee about women's unfair responsibility for unpaid care and domestic work. We are a charity that has for 30 years supported children, young people and adults with a profound learning and multiple disabilities and their families to lead healthy, valued and inclusive lives. Through our family support service and from academic research, we know that the main unpaid carers of this group of people are women, and in many cases as lone parents. Their caring role is intense and complex, and even more so during this recent pandemic. Evidence tells us that a high proportion of these unpaid carers face deterioration in physical and mental well-being. Their caring role is particularly prolonged, demanding and complex, along with the many challenges that parallel care of a loved ones with complex medical needs. Carers of children and adults with profound learning and multiple disabilities present unique challenges for support services. First, they may be the most medically skilled group of unpaid carers, but their experience is that their knowledge and skills often go unrecognised among health and social care professionals. Second, there is an indication that there is a high percentage of women who are single parent families, often caring for other children, some of whom also have additional support needs. And third, the overwhelming emotional experience of having a child diagnosed with life-limiting disabilities may be felt as unresolved trauma for many families, which lead to further triggering and difficulties, particularly related to the care of their child. However, there are no specialist support service existing to support and emotionally resource this group of family carers, particularly those managing such complex care. People with a profound learning and multiple disabilities require 24/7 care, and many carers are providing between 8 and 16 hours a day of this care. At worst, during the pandemic, we have seen unpaid carers providing round-the-clock support. Recent research by the Fraser of Allender Institute provides invaluable evidence on the role of this unique group of unpaid carers, a role for life which is unlike many other carer groups. The research highlights the savings to the taxpayer of this unpaid care. It would cost £114,000 per person per year to deliver the equivalent care. These caring commitments restrict the family carer's ability to work, and many carers are living below the poverty line. We know that many women wish to return to work or enter work in employment, but the expectation and the norm is that they will fulfil this full-time carer role. We have heard from carers who have been told that they are the person's mother and therefore are required to care for their child with complex disabilities, that they must coordinate the care of that child, and that it's not the duty of the statutory bodies to support them to return to work by providing adequate care packages. And yet one mother also highlights that her right to be a mother is overtaken by the demand for her to be the physio, the nurse, the teacher, the occupational therapist, the speech and language therapist, the care assistant, leaving no time to be a mum to that child or indeed to her other children. This mum also highlighted the desire to remove herself from the poverty line, to provide for her family and to seek appropriate housing where she can afford her rising few bills. She's recently been supported to take up a part-time role in our charity, but the barriers she faced in accessing this opportunity alongside the prejudices from statutory services who should be supporting her were enormous, and remarkably she's navigated the benefits trap and the care package issues, and with our flexibility in her working hours has been able to work. Would this be the same challenge for her daughter's dad, she asks, and this week when there was an issue with her daughter's care, who was the first port of call? Not the daughter's dad, but her as the mother. We feel we need to challenge a widespread belief that the role of family caregiver should be reserved for women, while men are not required to make the same level of commitment, and to uphold the rights of these women to have a livable standard of living, a right to health and a right to work. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much for both of your opening statements. So obviously there's a smaller panel than we've been having of late. So there should be time for us to ask each question to both of our witnesses. And I guess there's a bit of time potentially for supplementaries on those issues. So if members can indicate if they do want a supplementary, sticking on the same topic before we move on to the next question, that would be helpful. And members might want to indicate who they were wanting to hear from first. For witnesses, if you do feel that you're not being brought in on something that you're really keen to make sure to contribute on, if you put R in the chat. But I get the feeling that today we'll probably want to hear from both of you on each of the topics going through. So we'll now move to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe. And good morning, Pauline and Jenny. Thank you very much for joining us this morning and for your opening remarks. The statements and testimonies that you outlined and you gave us are very powerful. Jenny, if I can come to you first, I'm interested in exploring some of the physical and mental sort of consequences of the pandemic that people had in their well-being. You talked about a deterioration in both physical and mental well-being. Can you say a little bit more about the health impacts that you saw in the carers that you support?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, those quotes actually came prior to the pandemic. And I think what the pandemic did was put a real spotlight. But I think families talk to us about feeling abandoned and isolated and invisible. And the impact of having no support coming in and still actually, Maggie, there is no support. We have limited day services in a lot of areas. People that had 5 days a week care now have nothing or have 2 days a week. So families are absolutely exhausted. I mean, the really awful impact has been that we have seen families with suicidal tendencies because they just don't know where to go, that they have children who they really love, but they are now having to think about putting into residential care because they're exhausted and they can't cope. And we know that there is a shortage in care providers. We know that we've got a national crisis around social care provision. So their emotional well-being has really deteriorated. But alongside that, I mean, we also noted a lot of physical deterioration because families are suddenly having to do all the moving and handling, you know, all the lifting, and relatives midway in the pandemic had put on weight. So, you know, there was no, upgrading of equipment. So it had an enormous impact. The COVID research, the UK COVID research, you know, highlighted a percentage of families that felt that their health and physical well-being had declined, as had their children's. And I think one of the really awful images is the fact that families saw their children deteriorating, that their skills, their health, and things that they could do before the pandemic, because they've had no input, they're not doing. So yeah, it's really dramatic and it's still going on.
Thanks very much for that, Jenny. Pauline, could I bring you in on this as well, the sort of physical and mental consequences for disabled people and for the people around them as well, that you'll have experience of from the people you work with?
So our and others' surveys showed that disabled women's mental health deteriorated sharply since the pandemic, and physical health too, and both have an impact on each other. Those with care responsibilities, as Jenny's outlined, felt undersupported or unsupported. To add to that, many disabled queer people and shielders felt abandoned and experienced extreme loneliness, isolation and depression. And this is backed up by Sisters of Frida, the disabled women's organisation, and our own survey, which was a big theme of the April 2020 survey that we did. Fawcett Society and Budget Group found that 56% of disabled women reported finding social isolation difficult to cope with, compared to 41.6% of disabled women. Anxiety was highest among women overall, but particularly disabled women, with over half of disabled women reporting high anxiety. And Sisters of Frida say that they also felt let down by the public attitudes to social distancing and mask wearing. and this impacted on their access to community and green spaces. This has been a long-term issue, so it continues to affect disabled women and women affected by disability. At the beginning of the pandemic, we know that disabled women weren't accessing either preventative healthcare treatments or necessary treatment for their health conditions. They were either considering themselves possible burden on the NHS and didn't want to, they wanted to put others before themselves, or they had concerns and fears that they would catch COVID. And a lot of the, we've heard from disabled women that some of the sort of unofficial health treatments, but are still important treatments that disabled women accessed via, health and beauty shops and hairdressers, also were shut down to them. And so pain management techniques that disabled women had found worked for them were no longer available. It's had a huge impact on families as well. I think my colleague Susie in the last session talked about disabled women and women carers of disabled children who were, suddenly having to look after disabled children who were supporting them with rising also mental health conditions for themselves, for the children. So because they weren't getting outside, because they weren't getting to their usual supports, and the women themselves didn't have the support to look after them, they didn't have the respite services available. So both that was, so there was a quote here, "My youngest child not being at school is proving difficult for my mental health and my health, as I'm now struggling to care for her 24 hours a day. I normally have 2 nights respite per week and 1 weekend daytime respite to rest in order to help me pace and cope and keep on top of housework, etc. The stress and extra required activity is making my symptoms worse." And then, the additional struggles as well, all the struggles of getting shopping and access to medication, it's all had an impact.
Thanks very much, Pauline. That's really helpful. I'll leave it there for now. Thanks, Joe.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Duncan-Balancy.
Thank you, convener. And thank you also to the panel for the evidence that your organisations have given us in advance, but also for joining us here today, especially on International Women's Day. I think it's particularly special that we're taking evidence on disabled women today, because in order to break the bias for women in general, we have to look at us in all our glorious shapes and sizes. So I'm delighted to be joined by you all on our panel today. Can I also just point members to my register of interest as an employee of Inclusion Scotland from 2009 to 2015. I'd also like to take a moment just to remember Susan McKinley, and thank you, Pauline, for reading out that quote from Susan, who was an absolute powerhouse of the disability movement and a woman who shall be sorely, sorely missed. The evidence that you've already given us this morning, both of you, has been moving and stark. And I have a couple of questions in a few areas. The first I have is probably for yourself, Pauline, if that's okay. It's lovely to see you again. And I want to just ask a little bit about the Rights at Risk report and the fact that you've highlighted a number of disabled people's human rights were breached, and that we could be seeing a regression, I guess, in the rights that disabled women have. Could you tell us a bit about that and what you think needs to be done to address it? Could you also maybe set out what your aspirations for the new disability equality plan in that context would be? What is the scale of the challenge that we have, and what do we need to do to improve circumstances and reverse the regression?
Thanks, Pam, and it's good to see you too. That's a big question. The sort of asks from the new disability equality plan, we're just starting to work on that with Scottish Government and other disabled people's organisations in the Scottish Independent Living Coalition. But yes, our Rights at Risk report was based on a survey that we conducted in April 2020 of over 800 disabled people. And it really did show the mental health impacts that I just talked about above all. But it also showed that rights to Article 19 rights to independent living, for example, where, you know, people were having, women were having their social care support removed overnight with no discussion. A further survey later on that year showed that some of these people were still being charged for that social care support, and some women could no longer access their housing because they had no support in their own house and had to go and live with families and rely, you know, increase those reliant relationships, dependency relationships. So just to say, I'm just moving through my evidence. If we are to tackle gender inequality in relation to social care support, we need sustained public investment and in a modern nationwide infrastructure of social care support to protect, promote and ensure human rights and tackle inequalities for disabled people, and eligibility criteria and care charging to be removed. But also, disabled women need to be involved in setting any ambitions for the new plan. It needs to be realistic. It needs to not go over things that are already happening or that have been before, but it needs to look at things, ambitions that are achievable and can be done in co-design with disabled women and their supporters. To say that, so I'm moving. The Sisters of Freedom report states that as well as setting out the rights to dignity and access to services to meet rights to independent living that all disabled people have, the UNCRPD, which has been brought into Scottish law, also recognises that disabled women are subject to multiple discrimination and that measures need to be undertaken to ensure that our rights are protected and advanced in society. And so we'd like to know how policies such as the National Care Service Bill will align with the incorporation of the UNCRPD Article 19 to independent living and Article 6 to non-discrimination against disabled women and girls. An immediate method of easing the strain of caring responsibility of women impacted by disability would be Scottish Government to reopen the Independent Living Fund. This was seemed to be on the table, but as with the National Care Service, it's nowhere to be seen. Reopening it to new applications for people that need it and extend what funds can be used for. The Independent Living Fund enables disabled people to pay for care so that they can be supported in their homes and within their local communities. However, it was closed to new applications in 2010. Reopening of the ILF could be done immediately and could provide much needed support to couple with to people with high support needs and their carers. We think that's something that needs to be urgently added to all the work going on in the National Care Service and while they're working on other ways to improve social care support.
Thank you. Convener, can I ask two further questions?
If it's in the same area?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
Thank you. It was just to ask whether or not you'd carried out any analysis on the impact of shielding on disabled people's ability to continue to work during the pandemic and what sort of support's been put in place by employers to enable that.
Yes, yeah, I'll just go to that on my evidence. I've got 12 pages of evidence here. So we did look at shielding. We did an additional survey of over 150 disabled people on their experiences of shielding. And we did find that disabled people, including disabled women, were really concerned that they would lose their job. Around 1 in 10 respondents were, that's 11%, were concerned that they could lose their job as a result of the pandemic. Discriminatory work practices and the government's failure to implement fair employment regulations led to unemployment, reduced work hours and reduced pay. That's from Sisters of Freedom. There's been a big, you know, failure to adapt to home working for disabled women, particularly for disabled women with caring responsibilities, responsibilities for looking after children and older people, and particularly that's in low-paid jobs and public-facing jobs, I think. Is that helpful? Sorry, Pam.
It is. Thank you.
Okay.
I have other questions, but not on this thing.
Okay. Thank you. Alexander Stewart, please.
Thank you, convener. And can I also welcome Pauline and Jenny to the meeting and thank you for your comments and opening statements. We've heard, and you've also given some ideas in your opening statements about the concerns that women have, particularly when it comes to their financial security and their future financial security. Now, we're well aware that disabled women themselves found themselves during the pandemic or even prior to the pandemic in certain situations where they were having to deal with a cost of living, and that has only exacerbated during recent times. So as we progress, it would be good to get a view from you on specific to disabled women, but it may be that also age came into that, that depending on how old they were and what they were having to deal with, their ethnic background, whether they were a lone parent, and the impact that may have had on their financial security and the stability. We've heard a lot in the past about individuals saying, well, they have choices to make, and those choices might be eating or heating, and how they manage that situation and circumstance. So it would be good to get a view from maybe Jenny to begin with and then Pauline about what your experiences of that are, and do you feel that any specific women with an individual background are more susceptible, are more in crisis because of that situation where their financial security is challenged and is an everyday situation for them, having to manage their family, their lifestyle and their opportunities?
Yeah, thank you, Alexandra. Actually, we had last week a case of a mum who's rising fuel costs. So she's a lone parent with two children in a house that is incredibly cold and drafty. Her daughter requires 24/7 care. She needs heating on in her room at all times. She has a variety of electrical equipment that obviously needs to be run. She has to run the washing machine 3 or 4 times a day, and her fuel costs have just gone from £286 to £874. And she doesn't know how she's going to pay that. And at the moment, she's heating her daughter's room, the disabled daughter, but she and her other daughter are sitting with 6 jumpers and no heating. And yeah, she's making those decisions about what she buys food-wise, in order to ensure that she can pay for that heating, but she can't pay for that heating. She's the mum that also wants to get out of that poverty trap and has been trying to get into employment, but there is the total expectation that she will be the person that will be delivering that care. And so I think particularly these lone parents, these women who are caring for really, really complex children, are absolutely in that poverty gap, and they can't see a way out of it.
Thank you. And Pauline, do you have similar experiences or other areas of this that you might want to comment on?
Yeah, you're right. The intersections of disability, gender, race, class, compound women's income poverty and increase their time poverty, as well as impacting on their health. To say that, though, there isn't really enough data about those intersections of disabled women. What we do know is that nearly half of all those living in poverty in the UK are either disabled people or live in a household containing a disabled person. But the official measure of poverty, i.e. households living on less than 60% of median income, fails to take into account the additional costs that Jenny was just talking about associated with disability. So in 2018, Scope found that Scots disabled people spent on average £632 a month on disability-related expenses. So, for example, additional heating, washing, taxis, special equipment and care costs. These are the highest excess costs in the UK. Disabled people had on average £108,000 fewer savings than non-disabled people. So once these costs are taken into account fully, 500,000 Scottish disabled people and their families are living in poverty. That's 48% in total of all people living in Scotland in poverty, despite making up only 22% of the population. So this is backed up by other research. Sisters of Frieda found that the cost of living for disabled women increased while income decreased, and many disabled women were not eligible to access the government's £20 uplift of universal credit. But there's also other issues that were brought to the fore during the pandemic, such as access to technology, which was vital for the switch to home working and homeschooling children. This was a particular problem for disabled women. Almost 40% of disabled mothers reported that their children didn't have access to the equipment they needed to study at home, such as a computer or printer, compared to 24.2% of non-disabled mothers. And that's from the Women's Budget Group, Fawcett Society, etc. report.
Thank you, Convener.
And Pam Gossall, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you, panel, Jenny and Pauline, for coming along today and your opening statements, and especially today on International Women's Day. My question's around, we've heard that the rates of domestic abuse and violence had increased through the pandemic for women. Was this the case for disabled women? And if so, were there specific impacts on disabled women? If so, how do you feel that we could have addressed that? My question goes out to Jenny first. Yeah, thanks.
Yes, thank you. One of the things that we have seen is that intensity of caring role and from family support directors feeding back, you know, that lack of support. And there was a case a couple of weeks ago where, you know, I think a father just absolutely lost it because of the stress and the strain within their household. I think I know that family support director then spent a whole week trying to find appropriate support services that could go in and alleviate some of that stress. You know, it was we haven't collected specific evidence. It's just, I guess, that the case studies that we're picking up. But I think it's and we know that family relationships break down when you have a child with really complex needs, and a child with complex needs who communicates in a challenging way causes even more issues. And I think just not having any social support and not having any respite has definitely heightened the issues that families are facing. There have been a few cases where, you know, families have had to leave the family home, where mothers have had to leave because of a breakdown in relationships. But it's just been really difficult for them to get any support, and for some of those families, they're the ones that are now thinking about their child going into residential care because they can't cope anymore. Sorry, Pam, that isn't a very good word, because we haven't got specific evidence, but just it's some of the cases that some of our family support directors are tackling, you know, at the moment. And I think, you know, parents have been left with more than one child that they've had to homeschool, you know, as well. And on top of that complex caring role, I think tensions have been incredibly high.
Thank you, Jenny. Just on that, Jenny, you mentioned obviously tensions were high. Is there any examples or anything you feel that basically could have been done more to address that?
I think families, you know, I use the word felt invisible. They felt completely out on a limb. I mean, some families said, you know, the only support that they had was the telephone calls from PAMIS. And I just think people just sometimes wanted somebody to phone up, see, you know, how they were doing. Some of the complex communication that their children exhibit, you know, and children that are growing and transiting into adulthood. You know, if you're alone, you know, small lady looking after a very large son, it is incredibly difficult, and not even having any phone calls. But I think families get really, really tired. I mean, I've heard of families talking about the fact that they've needed their child to go into residential care because they're so tired they don't even know what they're doing anymore. So I there just needs to be more support. But people also need an opportunity to get out of a house, and living in small accommodation, you know, with nowhere to have private conversations, is incredibly difficult.
Thank you, Jenny. Pauline, do you have anything to add there?
Yeah, backing up what Jenny said, but and on the experiences, but also Sisters of Frieda did some research on that I've spoken about. I talked about the dependency that disabled women have felt during the pandemic, dependency on others, and I think that's put a strain on family. And the Sisters of Frieda pointed to a dramatic increase in calls to domestic violence helplines and support services, saying that many disabled women would find it much harder to flee dangerous situations or to find refuges or services they need, and that includes accessible refuges, which there weren't enough of in the first place, to make that decision to leave. It's that care dependency relationship often. There are different forms of abuse that disabled women face in domestic abuse that diverge slightly from what you might call usual domestic abuse, such as medical abuse, abuse of medication, financial abuse, and so on. And we think that there are a lot, some of these issues were exacerbated for women with learning difficulties as well, because a lot of the access to one-to-one advocates went away during the pandemic, and also women with other communication barriers. So yeah, it's been a huge issue, but actually a lot has been needed done to improve access to disabled women to domestic abuse services over many years. And again, it's one of these issues that's been exacerbated by families being stuck in the home.
Thank you, Pauline.
And Pam Duncan-Glancy would like a wee sup.
Thank you. My question was actually on the care dependency relationship and the situation that Pauline's just outlined, so I don't need to ask it. It's already been covered.
Okay, thanks. Good. Thank you. Moving then to Karen Adam, please.
Stay to Pauline and Jenny this morning, and thank you for coming along and giving evidence. You've spoken in regards to disabled people facing additional restrictions on their activities and freedoms due to being at higher risk of more severe impacts of coronavirus and needing to shield completely, and that feeling of more vulnerability to the exposure of the virus. Overall, disabled people during COVID were more likely to spend extended periods without leaving their home, especially women and those with unpaid care responsibilities. And I was just looking at some research what was saying that the proportion of people who had not left a house to go for a walk or exercise or go shopping in the previous week before this was 16.6%. However, this rose to 25.5% of disabled women. But ensuring the clinically vulnerable people were isolating at home was an essential part of the coronavirus response. But going for extended periods of time without leaving the house could have significant impacts on mental and physical health. And data suggests that this is likely to have particularly impacted disabled people, disabled women. So I would like to ask, what are the views of the panel, and are there lessons that can be learnt about this scenario that can help with anything in the future? And can I direct that first at Pauline, please?
Yeah, disabled women and disabled people in generally need to be involved. It's actually their Article 11 rights in the United Nations Convention on Disabled People to be involved in any measures that would be put in place for emergency situation, and that would have potentially put them at less risk from both the virus and the measures to control it if we'd been involved in emergency planning. As it was, as the pandemic came on and emergency planning was happening at such a fast rate, there was no involvement of disabled people's organisations or disabled people in that emergency planning. And therefore, we believe that that actually put disabled people and disabled women in particular at more risk to the pandemic and its the restrictions put in place because of it.
Thank you. Jenny, please.
Yeah, we absolutely, Karen, and it was one of our arguments all the way along that actually getting access to the outdoors, particularly for our group of people, was so important. And those tensions, as you mentioned, that rose in houses where people weren't getting out because they needed that activity. And I think there was just this blanket risk assessment. And I know that for some people living in, you know, in shared accommodation and care homes, there was absolutely no opportunity to get out. And we know that that did and has and will continue to have an impact on the health and well-being of people with complex needs and their family carers, and that damage has been done and it will never be undone. But one mum was saying the other day, you know, I wanted to take my daughter out, and I was told categorically that I couldn't. But actually, she said, in reality, when I go to the park with my daughter, nobody rushes up to chat to us anyway. It was far safer going out to a park into an open space, giving her that opportunity to be out and to exercise, then it would have been keeping her, you know, locked up indoors. And I think, as Pauline was saying, what we would have really appreciated is more personalised risk assessments. I think, you know, there was recommendations from the government that said, please do risk assessments and do them with individuals. We found that when we did risk assessments with families, they absolutely understand the needs of their children and wanted to keep them safe. And their risk assessments, you know, minimised risks. There was no way you could get rid of every risk. But I just wish there had been more collaboration with organisations, as Pauline highlighted. But that damage has been done, and we need to remember, if we're ever in that position again, just how important physical activity is for the well-being of everybody. And I think it would have made a huge difference if we had enabled people to get out and about, particularly in that, you know, that first lockdown when the weather was reasonable. But I think this group of people were far more discriminated against and not able to do, you know, as we all started going to the pub, they were still locked down. Yes, thank you for that question.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you, Jenny. And I think Pauline, we'd like to come back in.
Yeah, there's a lot of disabled women still locked down, in fact, and we need to go to those disabled women about and disabled people about what their, you know, what the solutions are, what can be done to prevent their risk from catching COVID, because it's still an issue for a lot of disabled people. And as she said, as Jenny says, sorry, we also need decision makers and service providers to understand that disabled women's lives are complex, both from their intersections with the other protected characteristics, and also where they live in the country, where what supports they do and don't have, what poverty they face. So it all needs to be brought in inclusively into the mix when looking at solutions and future planning.
That's really helpful. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Now go to Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks, Joe. I want to follow up on one of the topics that you both started exploring with Alexandra around financial security, but I suppose particularly from the point of view of education and training. And Jenny, you spoke about the poverty trap, and obviously people not having access to a range of employment options, or having to curtail their paid work because of caring responsibilities. I suppose there's also something in that around curtailing other development opportunities, skills development, training, education. And I wonder, Jenny, I'll come to you first and then to Pauline, if you could say a little bit more about the impacts on access to education, skills and training that carers and disabled people will have experienced during the pandemic.
Yeah, Maggie, and I think the group of families that we support, you know, many of them have given up very prestigious and well-paid jobs to take on their full-time caring role. And actually, it's been really depressing seeing the lack of confidence, you know, when they start applying for roles where they feel that they have lost so many skills. Mm. I'm really interested in looking at providing a family carer job description, because we're pretty sure that it would map to an SVQ level 5 in supervisory management because of all the jobs that they, you know, they take part in, the care management, the financial management. You know, there's a huge range of skills, but finding that the time for them to attend training, to be able to further their education, to think about jobs, is so difficult, and it has to be so flexible. And what we're finding is that the flexibility of courses and employment just isn't appropriate for people that have to, you know, at the drop of a hat, then take a child to hospital or, you know, provide emergency support. So I think that there needs to be real consideration. We're at the moment just put in a funding application for empathetic employment and routes into empathetic employment, and providing support and buddying for families who've managed to manoeuvre their way around the benefit system and the barriers, but to support each other, you know, back into routes into employment. And I think, as I highlighted at the beginning, the group of families that we support are probably some of the most skilled carers that we have. And can we look at how we translate the skills that they've developed into accredited you know, vocational qualifications? So we've certainly been looking at, with the clinical skills network in Scotland, to talk about accrediting some of the invasive procedures that some of these families have learnt on the job, really, because they are a very highly skilled workforce. And very sadly, many of them lose their children earlier in life, and then you have a whole wealth of skills that we feel goes untapped, because they've not been given the possibilities and the support to then think about employment. But I think we as employers need to really consider how we support this group of people, who are an absolute asset if you just provide the right conditions. And you think about flexibility is absolutely key. Sorry, Maggie, have I gone off on a tangent there? I'm a bit passionate about that one.
No. Thanks, Jenny. That's really helpful. Thank you. And I mean, I think the empathetic employment and the role that employers or the adaptations that employers need to be thinking about, I think more generally, inclusion is good for everybody, isn't it? It's not just the people that it's maybe designed for. Pauline, do you want to come in on this as well? And yes, you also please. Talked earlier about the need for people to, you know, feel fulfilled and feel that they're actually able to do something that they want to do, not just be stuck indoors, stuck at home. How have the people you work with and support felt through all of this?
Well, I spoke earlier as well about lack of digital support and lack of accessible equipment to get involved in education. It's one of those things, again, to coin the phrase that Glasgow Disability Alliance use, has supercharged existing pre-pandemic inequalities in relation to access to work and qualifications. There is also the cost of broadband has been a prohibitory barrier to disabled women. There's the juggling of work and social care cuts and childcare that, you know, is in our evidence, and caring for relatives. There were issues with the inflexibility of the system as well, of access to work requiring wet signatures to endorse claims for access to work, which, you know, has been a big problem as well. Inclusion Scotland provides employment opportunities for disabled graduates and disabled people who have been out of work via paid internships, some parliamentary, some with Scottish Government and others with the public sector. These are highly successful because we couple it with training for employers. So actually one of the things that needs to be done is to look at employability of employers rather than the looking at disabled individuals' own deficiencies regarding work and education. So these employability programmes that have come along and said this is what you need to access work actually don't always help when workplaces themselves are inaccessible, both in terms of physical access but also in terms of attitudes. Very often to disabled people and disabled women, of course, are victims of the dual intersectional bias against them in workplaces. And then you've got the intersections of impairment, of course. So mental health will have, you know, will come with its own biases from employers and from educational establishments as well. And not enough's being done to address both the barriers and to train. We do that training, but we think that more needs to be done to train employers to become accessible employers.
We've got a lot of work to do, don't we? A lot of culture change to get on with. Thanks, Jo.
Thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener. Sticking with employment first, if that's okay, and then I have a question on social security. You've highlighted some of the significant barriers to employment that disabled women experience in general. What do you think we'll need to do specifically as a result of what we've seen in the pandemic and the kind of rolling back of rights that we've had from that? And if you think about the government's main initiatives on employment to do that are the No One Left Behind approach, Parental Employability Fund, the Green Jobs being targeted, the Women in Business Centre and Modern Apprenticeships. Can you talk a little bit about the inclusion of disabled people and unpaid carers in those and what it would need in order for those to take account of disabled people's needs?
Who do you want to speak first, Pam?
Do you want me to use our girl? I mean, I think, Pam, I think something that Pauline said earlier was about that engagement with the people themselves. I mean, when we talk to the family carers, I mean, the project that we're looking at, the Empathetic Route to Employment, is totally led and brought forward by family carers who have a passion and a drive to make sure they can get back into the market. And they come up with the most amazing creative ways of getting over the barriers and managing their really complex lives. And I think we need to do far more engagement with the people themselves that require these services. I mean, families will often say to us, we're not asking for the earth, we're just asking for someone to work with us in order for us to look at solutions. But it is complicated. And I and our other ask is often, why not spend a day in their shoes, a day in the life of their experience, to really understand what it is that they've got to cope with. But certainly Carolyn, that is working with us, has done a detailed step-by-step account of the barriers that she had to overcome in order to be able to get into employment. And you know, one of the biggest ones, which maybe feeds into your next question, was, you know, how do I make sure that I earn enough money to look after my child and come off the benefits? Because I know that once I've come off them, getting back will be really difficult and really complicated. And she had to have many, many, many conversations with the benefits agencies in order to work out how she could do that in a way that meant she wasn't destitute you know, before she started working. But I think engagement with the people themselves, I'm just always, and I think it's what gets me up to going to work, is inspired by families who and people with disabilities who absolutely know what the solutions are, but we just maybe need to think about how we make those a reality.
And I'll come in if that's okay. Workplaces and educational establishments need to be more flexible in their approaches to including disabled people and disabled women in particular. But also there is a need for social care support to be properly in place and for unmet needs to be met, because if somebody can't leave their house in the morning, can't get on public transport in the morning, they have no opportunities to be involved in these programmes that you speak of. The programmes themselves, like, you know, the call for employability, they need to be more flexible and accessible. Another point to make on this topic is a lot of disabled women work in jobs that were formerly seen as unskilled, and those jobs became key work during the pandemic. So actually those key work roles need to be fully recognised, including unpaid carers and including support workers, which is predominantly feminised, and including, you know, all the public service low paid sector, which, you know, women, disabled women had to go out and work in shops and were put at increased risk, and actually were probably due danger money because of that increased risk to COVID-19. In terms of benefits, disabled people and disabled family need to have benefits uplifted to the point where they can afford to meet their additional costs. But it's as simple as that. We have a benefit system that has focused on deficiency and seen disabled people as scroungers for the last 10 years. And we need to turn that round to give disabled people and disabled women opportunities to work, to take part in society, to take part in the communities. It's an investment.
Get us on to another area that Pam was looking to go into. So back to Pam, please.
Thank you, convener. I was keen to understand a bit about the financial impact, if that's all right, of the pandemic, particularly on disabled women, but also on unpaid carers. And I just want to pick up a point that Jenny made earlier in your opening remarks around families being expected to pick it up and someone being told, you're their mum, you should just do it. And I just recall, and I think it'd be nice to put it on record, when I finally got the social care and support that I needed, my mum, I remember it very specifically, my mum said, I can now be your mum and not your carer. And so I think it's incredibly important. I was 18, incidentally, so she'd done that for 18 years. I think it's really important that we don't just make assumptions about unpaid care. So, yeah, if you could talk a little bit about both of you, if that's OK, the financial impact of the pandemic and some of the support that was put in place, for example, the doubling of the carers allowance supplement and how helpful that might have been.
Do you want to go through first, Pauline?
Well, I've already mentioned some of the financial impacts on disabled women. The uplift to carers allowance was still, I believe, below the rate at which, you know, the standard rates that can put people into poverty. So whilst it was welcomed, I think more needed to be done. There should be a focus on that in the upcoming carers strategy. I've talked about the impacts of poverty, so I'll allow Jenny to come in on that.
Yeah, I think that the families that we supported, I guess, you know, and what's happening at the moment is there was nowhere for them to spend some of their care packages. So, because there were no services that were open. And I think the biggest issue at the moment now is this total clawback, where somebody's told on a Monday that by Friday they're going to take back all the, you know, the unclaimed money, which actually would be so useful if they could now find, you know, opportunities to have a respite from their caring role. So, you know, the impact for families was vast. And I think, you know, their heating bills, as we talked about, went through the roof. You know, many were not able to go back to work because they were caring, you know, 5 days a week, and, well, 7 days a week. And there wasn't the possibility to do that homeworking. I mean, I'm amazed some of the families that did manage to juggle some of that homeworking, but it was really, really difficult. And I think families have considered, you know, having to give up their work, particularly when there were some employers who were demanding that, you know, people worked, you know, set hours, which was almost impossible. And I think, you know, one of the other bits is in order for them to be able to work, they need to have the right care, which I was going to bring in after, you know, the access to appropriate care and that ability to hand over the care to somebody that you're not convinced is going to deliver it in the same way as you will, I think is also, you know, a real barrier to supporting people getting back into employment. But the poverty that I think is just going to be so stark is just this whole fuel crisis. And, you know, we've got families who just don't know what to do. And actually, I feel really awful as an organisation. I'm not even sure how to support them at the moment. We're having an emergency meeting this week with our board to talk about what do we do to provide that support. And I'm sure we'll maybe get in touch with Pauline to talk about what we do as organisations, because, you know, trebling somebody's monthly bills is just a recipe for disaster. Sorry, I'm waffling there.
No, I absolutely agree, and I'd like to come back in on that if that's okay.
Yep, that's fine.
Okay, thanks. We have a lived experience poverty group at Inclusion Scotland, but I'm so aware of just so many people facing stark decisions at the moment that you talked of choosing, you know, choosing what they do and the heating and use of fuel is, you know, is an additional cost of a lot of disabled people and disabled women and families of disabled people. So I really think that needs to be looked at in the policy context, especially going forward, because the war in Ukraine is also adding to that, adding to what's already a fuel crisis. And it's also the on cost of accessing paid for services, which are increasing their prices because of those increased bills. So, you know, you'll have disabled women who were unable to access the kind of paid for beauty services that they needed to manage pain that we were told about last year because they were closed. But now it will be because they can't afford to.
Thanks very
Thank
much.
You.
Pam Gossel.
Thank you, convener. I just wanted to go back to what my colleague Pam spoke about, apprenticeships. This week is also Apprenticeship Week, and I wanted to ask the question around access and take-up with apprenticeships for disabled people and how your links with organisations like Skills Development Scotland, Apprenticeship Scotland, do you have any links with these people? And how is it working? And if it's not working, that is it something that you're looking at?
Very, very timely question, Pam. Is that for Jenny first?
Yes, Jenny first, yes. Thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you. And I think I've just made a note of those because that's certainly in the project that we're looking at of how to get family carers back into employment. We were really keen to look at how we work with organisations, I think, to recognise the skills that these families have already developed and then accredit them so that they then can look at where they go. And I guess our conversations will need to be, again, back to that flexibility in how you support people into apprenticeships and into skills training that enables them to carry on with their caring role. But wouldn't it be fantastic if these family carers were able to accredit these wealth of skills that they, you know, have developed through their caring role, and that's recognised and affirms, I suppose, the value that they have. But that's certainly something we would hope to be developing as we go forward.
Anything on that?
I'll come in on that. I think, you know, Glasgow Disability Alliance are publishing their report At the end of this week on the triple whammy of impacts on disabled women from the pandemic, from being disabled, having those barriers from being a woman and the pandemic, the COVID pandemic. And they talk of employment opportunities dried up for disabled women job seekers as the job market has become more competitive. We do work with Skills Development Scotland. We're working on them at the moment on delivering training to the hotel and tourism industry, actually, on our employability training. Just a short-term project that will hopefully have a big impact because it's a industry where a lot of disabled people are actually in employment, and it's probably hidden the number of disabled people that are in employment and face barriers also to employment in that sector. A lot of disabled people's work in the past has also been segregated, and we don't want to see that, and that's why we do these employability training and internships, is to ensure that disabled people are included in mainstream work. As many of these projects in the past did have value for disabled people, but segregated them from society and also allowed mainstream employers to not know what the barriers they were placing for disabled people were.
Just got a bit more to ask there, Pauline. Just on that, Pauline, I wanted to ask, obviously you're working with Skills Development Scotland. Do you think there more needs to be done on promoting and making people aware that apprenticeships are there for accessible for all, including disabled people?
They need to be more accessible. Yes, more does need to be done. And we are working. It's not me that's doing that work, though, so I can't go into as much detail. But I'm very happy to follow up by my colleagues that are working in that area, Pam, if that would be helpful.
Thank you, Pauline. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further questions from any members? Well, OK, thanks very much. Thanks, Jenny and Pauline. That's been really helpful. There's a number of areas that I think that the committee will want to consider how we can look further into to try and get the movement on some of those areas that you were talking about. That's been really, really helpful, and it's good that we were able to have a bit more of an in-depth discussion around the topics rather than always feeling that we were chasing our tails. But thank you both for your time. That brings the public part of our meeting to a close. So the next meeting will be on Tuesday, the 15th of March, and I now close the public part of this meeting and move into private session for the final item on our agenda. Thank you.